You know, it's fun being here. It's like full circle. I went to college and signed up to be a physics major, and I fell in love with a math professor and started taking every single class he offered. And eventually he said, okay, I've kind of let you into some of these classes without the prereqs and everything, but for this one, you have to be an English major to take. And I was taking like 4,000 level English classes just to, you know, like literary criticism, just whatever he was teaching. And so I had to double major. And so that was the beginning of my life away from working in a laboratory like you guys do, to making up really bad science and doing that for a living. So I feel like I've come full circle. I probably wasn't smart enough to make it as a physics major anyway, so getting into the humanities was probably the right move. So one way to tie this in with what you guys do, we like to think of science as being really neat. We're all familiar with the diagram, the scientific method, and you know, it's observation and hypothesis and testing and conclusion. And now, if you look at these diagrams, they've actually added all kinds of steps in there, and there's arrows going, everything's recursive, and there's no telling where you're gonna start. That's how you become a writer. There's also this, a lie that I grew up with, that authors decided they're gonna be writers at a young age, and they go and study English, and they go and get an MFA, and they write their first novel, and they break out, and that's how you become a writer. Most of the writers that I know have more of a background like I have, which I can go more in depth to because it's pretty bizarre. But it's having a lot of different interests, a lot of different careers. It's, you know, John Grisham coming from being a lawyer to write about law. It's James Patterson with a background in advertising to paying people to write his books. So it's, well, that makes sense. I'm trying to work on that too. So for me, if I would have set out to be a writer, I wouldn't have had this level of success. It's having worked a lot of jobs and having traveled a lot and having a lot of life adventures. That's what I tell a lot of people who are young and dreaming of being a writer. It's there's a few things you can do. Enjoy being poor, enjoy your day job, and read a lot, live a lot, and write a lot. And that's a lot of my friends who are making it as writers have these things in common. So I think we live in probably the most exciting time to be a reader or a writer. I was talking with someone earlier while we were signing books about traveling with their Kindle and the immediate gratification, and they finish a book at 2 o'clock in the morning and they download the next one when they probably should be getting some sleep since they work in a pretty important place like this. Little worried after having some conversations about how little sleep some of you are getting. It's a great time to be a reader. There's a bookstore in your home now, and you can, whether that's ordering it on a physical book online or downloading a book, just the ease of access is different than when I was a kid and I had to beg my mom to take me to the mall or take me to the library. Also, the diversity of books that are available now is incredible. But for a writer, which I've always wanted to be since I was 12 years old and tried to write my first novel, which was a complete ripoff of Douglas Adams' Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Same really bad humor and, almost the same plot. It was like my first piece of fan fiction, really. Since that age, I've tried to write a lot of books and given up. And I've also thought, as someone who's seen the book industry as a bookseller in college and later in life as a book reviewer, how few people make it. So in 2009, I went to a conference and got really motivated, like I'd been motivated a lot of times before, came home and actually finished a novel, which was this one on the far left here, this Mollified and the Parsona Rescue. It was a character that I had dreamt up during my roofing days when I had a lot of time, spent 2 years when I got off of boats to just gather your thoughts and daydream. And I actually thought up the story of Wool and this character. And when I wrote that first book, all I knew about getting published was you had to, and I had to kind of study this to find out how to do it, but you had to query agents and, you know, ask permission for someone to ask someone else permission to get the book out before you even ask people to read the thing. So I went through that whole process, and it was grueling. But I was also very fortunate that I had a publisher pick up my first book and publish it. Watching them do it and seeing some of the technology that was coming online in 2009, I started questioning whether or not this was the right way to publish a novel. I was already used to self-publishing in the extent that we all write on blogs, we all post to, back then it wasn't Facebook, I'm not even sure MySpace was around in 2009. But we were used to putting our words out for people to consume ourselves. And so I thought, why am I doing all of this when I could just, I'm not gonna make any money doing it anyway. I mean, no one makes money writing. That's what I thought then. So why didn't I just put the book on my blog for free, part by part? But I had people can read it, read the draft, and convince me I should get it published, and that's what I did. After watching that process, I thought, yeah, I think I could do, you know, everything they're doing and hire out the things that I need with a one-time cost, you know, like editing and cover art, rather than paying someone like 85% of my earnings for the rest of my life to do the exact same things. This is a very scary, looking back on this, it seems so logical the way it all worked out for me. It worked out very well. But at the time, it was terrifying. I mean, I had someone, I had the dream, I had someone who was willing to publish my book. Why would I go do it on my own? And so as I'm sitting there holding a contract that every writer wants to get, and I decided to file it away and strike out on my own, it was one of the scariest things I ever did. It was also the smartest decision that I ever made. The world is being changed by the digitization of everything. You guys see this. Once you start looking for it, you see it in every field, you see it in every facet of your life. The cost of production and the cost of distribution for anything that can be digitized is going to zero. And that's a very powerful new numerator in any equation. So that means it's just your time. You own the laptop, which is already a pretty amazing device that you own that can do images and upload metadata and books to websites, can do all the word processing. It's a very powerful machine. You already own it. The rest is just your time. And then you have a book that you can upload. So doing these calculations, I thought, yeah, this seems like a good risk. You know, I had my wife's shoulder to cry on as I made this decision. And threw my first, the second book there, threw that up online. And the cool thing about this was that I didn't worry about how the book was doing. It was published, it was out of my hands. I could write the next book, I could write books in another series. I was more productive in the first 3 years of writing than I thought I would be in a lifetime. I wasn't worrying about sales, wasn't doing any of that stuff. So in July of 2011 is when I published a short story that would completely change my life. It was the least commercial thing I ever wrote. I did no promotion for it because I thought no one would want to read this thing. It was just the first 50 pages of, if you've downloaded the free file that we made available, it was just the first part, Holston's story. And I made it as cheap as Amazon would let me make it, which was 99 cents. I would have given it away because that's how much faith I had in this story, which goes to show how much I know. I know nothing about, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm fumbling through all this. So I made it as cheap as possible. I threw it up and I forgot about it. I went back to writing my next novel. Within 3 months, this little short story started selling more than I had sold in my previous 3 years of all my other books combined. So in October of 2011, just a few months later, it sold 1,000 copies that month. And I'm working in a bookstore this time for $10 an hour. It's only a 30-hour a week job. And my wife and I live in a 750 square foot house. She's just finishing up her doctorate in psychology, which means she's broke. Worse than broke, she's in massive debt, you know. But we have a kind of a debt-free life and simple life, which is part of becoming a writer. And all of a sudden, I'm selling 1,000 books in 1 month, and then 3,000 the next month, and 10,000 the month after that. And this is more in a month than I thought I would sell in a lifetime. And the way the royalty structure works out, it's like I was making as much in a day as I made in a week, and eventually as much as I made in a month at the bookstore, which was terrifying my boss. He was sitting beside me the whole time watching me refresh this, and he's like, so your two-week notice is in? Like, what are you going to do? My dream was that I would stay at the, I loved my bookstore job, and I was going to stay in the bookstore and just write and publish, and things started getting crazy where students were coming up. We were affiliated with a university, and students would come up and have me sign their book while I was working there, which drove my boss crazy, because, like, this was his dream, you know. to be a writer. He just wasn't writing. It was his dream, but he wasn't doing it. So it was really torturous for him to watch it unfold for me. We're still very good friends, so I can rag him all day long about this. Eventually I got to where I really couldn't stay at the bookstore. I was fielding calls from publishers. We had Hollywood get in touch and want to do a TV series. And then when I signed on with an agent, they sent it out to all the A-listers in Hollywood, and we ended up doing a film deal with Ridley Scott and 20th Century Fox, which was really quite exciting. And this self-published book went onto the New York Times bestseller list and stayed there. And 3 years later, it's still in the top 200 on Amazon, and it's just defied all expectations. One of the early, I signed on with an agent after turning a few agents down, which is a very bizarre experience for an author. It usually works the other way around, where you're just begging every agent to take you and they just send you a form rejection letter. And I was turning agents down, and I thought, I'm gonna have to write a form rejection letter because I don't have time to turn these agents down. It's like eating into my day. But I heard from an agent who said, you know, you probably shouldn't take a deal. And that really perked my ears up because someone was being honest with me. She's my agent to this day, and she's amazing. But she started sending the book around to publishers, and like you're hearing in the introduction, we've started getting offers that I would have killed for before, but at every step, they were a few months behind where the sales were going, and there were a lot of dangers with signing with a publisher, because they would saddle the ebook with DRM. For this, when they said, can we buy books to give, or donate books, and I was like, yeah, I'll just give you the ebook and you can give it away. And I think it freaked out the people I was dealing with. They were like, don't you try to do this for a living? But I have found that having low prices and no DRM and not worrying about piracy has been probably one of the secrets to my success. It's all about getting readers. The big danger is obscurity, not someone stealing your book. I used to, I'm familiar with the torrents, and I won't say why, except when you're broke and you're trying to make it as a writer, sometimes you have to like sample Photoshop before you buy a license for it and stuff like that. So I knew how to look for things, and I remember the first time I searched for myself on the torrents and nothing came up. It was one of the saddest days of my life. Why weren't people pirating me? And later I started getting emails from people. Once I knew I was being pirated, I stopped looking, but I was getting emails from people like, you're being pirated here. And I'm thinking like, yes, that's awesome. It's like another bookstore carrying my book. And then I heard from pirates that they were, how can they PayPal me or send me some money? They really enjoyed my book. So I had to put a button on my website with a little Jolly Roger on it. Like, if you've already read it and enjoyed it, you can pay for it here, but you don't have to. But it's like, because I was getting enough emails and I had to simplify my life by creating a pro piracy button. So this is how science works. You don't do what's expected. You don't, you kind of figure it out as you go. It's observation and testing and more observation. So that's kind of how I've approached this whole publishing thing. I'll try anything and see how it works. There's a lot of different examples I could go in that and probably bore you to death. So what I would like to do, since some of my background, like the jobs I've worked. Well, I didn't really get into the boating much. That's because you covered it so well, but that was a fascinating period of my life. A lot of what went into wool came from years as a yacht captain and working on these multi-million dollar boats I was a glorified bus driver. That's what I did for a living. And I was also the mechanic. Anything that broke, I had to fix. And as a huge Star Wars geek, I was totally Han Solo, just like, not as dashing and didn't have as glamorous. I didn't have a blaster on my hip, but I was always banging a piece of equipment with a hammer and cursing at it and like saying like, why now? Like, the engine would break down as you're in a between reefs and heavy current and wind blowing. And that's when things would break. And the cosmos was always being unfair to me. So a lot of the mechanical stuff that I put in my books has come from growing up on a farm, years of working on a boat where you don't get to call a mechanic. You have to learn to be the mechanic very quickly. So you also have to be an electrician, a plumber, the navigator, everything. And really it was the best training for me for owning a home, for writing books, for the lifetime of things breaking down that we all suffer. So the other thing about that career is that it really let me travel a lot, see a lot of cultures, and meet a lot of people, which is important for writing. The other thing that made it into the silo series was the stratification of the boat. You see in the silo how, you know, people in the mechanical and the mines are like, it's like the worst jobs are down low, and it's very much a class structure, talking about upper class and middle class and lower class. And the boats were the same. The bilge is at the very bottom, the engine room, and then where the crew slept. We slept really close to the engine room because it was the worst piece of real estate in the boat. And then the guests, which were right above us, and then you keep working your way up to the owner sitting on the top deck, you know, with a mojito and, you know, a stewardess fanning him and bringing him whatever he needs. And living in that really huge disparity of income informed this series quite a bit as well. As well as living in a time where reading the paper every day and you saw things like Occupy Wall Street going on and the Arab Spring, all these current events influenced the books as well. So that's a little bit of my history as a writer, a little bit about the books. The thing I'm really passionate about is this new age of publishing and reading, which I think is very exciting and fascinating. Whether you like print books or ebooks, it's never been easier to get a wider variety of titles at a better price. So I think I already see a hand up. Is that, are you just, no, you're just chilling that way? Cool. It's very, very confusing for public speaking. So do you not have a question? Okay. So I'd love to maybe take some questions. We have a microphone that we can pass around. Your question could lead to me talking for another 15 minutes about a different topic. So it's not like, don't feel any pressure. Just throw something out and we'll see where it goes. There's one way over here. If you could, space yourself out as much as possible to give these ladies as much exercise as possible.
So what did you use for the self-publishing? Did you go create a space, or what process did you take?
Okay. So the question is, what systems did I use, or what platforms did I use? I started off with, this is a crazy thing about being a self-published author, is you have to make all these decisions. What printer am I going to use? Where am I going to upload my books? I used a print-on-demand company called Lightning Source originally. Once I discovered CreateSpace, I switched to CreateSpace because their integration with Amazon is the best, and Amazon right now accounts for about half of print book sales. So with CreateSpace, you get your print-on-demand book, which the books that we handed out, and there's a copy of Wool here that was one of the original print-on-demand editions. The great thing about these, working in a bookstore, one of my primary jobs was to go around and collect the books that hadn't sold in the last 6 months, box them up, and send them back to the publisher where we'd get a full refund. Not too long ago, they would take those books and throw them in a furnace. Just to dispose of them. They were just burning books because they printed more than sold. Now they have a remaindering system where they try to sell them at discount. They might get donated. A lot of them get pulped. With print-on-demand, like CreateSpace uses, you order the book, they print it just within hours and ship it out that day. It's so much more efficient. It's more environmentally friendly. It's much more cost-effective. So not only are self-published authors using it, but now publishers are using this to pick up the slack when the demand outstrips the supply. When J.K. Rowling is outed for writing a book that's not selling and it goes crazy, they can use print-on-demand to pick up that slack. For the e-books, you have dozens of options, a place you can upload them. And you can control that all yourself by uploading to the Kindle store, to iTunes, to Nook, to Kobo, Google Play, or you could use a program like Draft to Digital, which will do all that work for you. Upload it to one place, they distribute it, and then they take a small cut. What's interesting about this, it sounds like a lot of work, but one of the great, the myths about self-publishing is that it's more work than publishing traditionally. It took me longer to learn how to write a query letter to send to agents than it took to self-publish my first book. A query letter is what we call this letter begging some agent to accept you. You don't care who it is, you'll take any agent. And it's very formal. There's rules, like this is the order things have to go in. People will spend more time trying to write a query letter than they spent writing their novel. It's there's that much pressure. It's like writing your resume, except you only get one shot. You know, if they turn you down, you're never gonna get another shot with them. I spent weeks working on my query letter for my very first novel. I spent 2 days, like, from not knowing anything about self-publishing to making my book available. There's a lot to learn, but if you want to be a writer, there's a lot to learn however you're going to go about this. See, excellent. And then the next one will be down here. You guys are learning fast.
Hi, I'm here for a friend who when he was going through stage 4 lymphoma, he wrote all of his experiences down, and he celebrated his 10 years, but everybody that gets the book, we're all trying to get him to publish it. So I want to know how much money I need to tell him he needs to start with to get this done, and how do you publicize it?
Good, great questions. So the question is, how much money does it cost to self-publish, and how much should you spend to publicize it? That's completely up to you. These are variables that time and money are the two big variables. How much of it do you want to do yourself? I didn't spend a penny self-publishing until I was already making more money than I needed for anything I wanted to do with self-publishing. I did covers myself. I was in a writing group and I exchanged editing with other people. You know, editing's one of those funny things. There's no really right way to edit. If you took a book that won the Pulitzer and handed it to 10 editors, they're all going to mark up the book. It's got so much wrong with it, so much they would change. You could accept all those changes and hand that off to another round of editors, and they're going to, some of them will change it, will suggest the previous edition. So what you need with editing is multiple eyeballs to look at the same work, because you can't be dispassionate about your own work. So you can get editing for free, or you can pay thousands of dollars for someone who edits for one of the big publishers to edit for you. You can make a cover art on Canva for $1, a website called Canva for $1. Or you can get original artwork for a few $100s, or you could pay someone thousands of dollars. A lot of this artwork was done by a Dutch master painter named Jasper Schurz, who also did the currency for I can't remember which island nation. Like this guy does Fortune 500 stuff. He sent me this first cover just as a fan. He just said, I did this in a weekend, and which really upset me as someone who like can't draw, you know? So it's this beautiful, original, hand-drawn painting with seeing my characters for the first time, and I really wept when I saw this. What he was doing was getting me hooked on it so that he knew I was making good money, and then I ended up commissioning three more covers. So it's completely up to you. That's the range of scale. The quality is going to depend on how much time or how much money you invest in that work. If you slap something together and throw it up there, it's going to be disappointing. If you get a lot of beta readers, everyone knows what a beta, I mean, since you guys all work in software and computers and labs, beta readers are invaluable. They all find something different. You incorporate those changes. You get the family to all read an early draft. But you shouldn't have to spend a lot of money. I mean, uploading is free. You don't have to get an ISBN number. You don't have to pay to have it copyrighted or registered at the Library of Congress. None of that stuff is necessary. I never did it, and my books were New York Times bestsellers and stocked in bookstores. So. Yeah, but if you have the money laying around, pay someone else to do it all. Just be really wary. You should never, there are vanity publishers who are actually taking the rights to your book, and you pay them thousands of dollars, and they're just taking advantage of authors. The good thing about self-publishing is it's destroyed those companies. For anyone who knows, you just don't have to use those anymore. You can now do everything yourself by hiring out the things that you need and uploading and owning your rights, which is, I think, the most important thing as an artist is to maintain your ownership of what you've put your work into. It's funny, we were laughing before the thing about how evenly spread everyone is, and I'm an introvert, so like it makes sense. Like it's like as much space as possible between everybody, and all this empty space in the front. Love it. I feel like I'm among my people.
Hi, I'm a big fan of your work. I've read, I think, almost everything you've written at this point. And one thing that really stands out for me is that you seem to use many of your heroes and major characters are these incredibly strong, interesting women. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about your inspiration and how that came to be.
That's a good question. I'm really lucky in that I'm very close to my dad, but I was raised by a single mom who worked three jobs to take care of three kids. And I spent over 12 years with a woman who's a badass, and I've watched her not just get her doctorate, but rise to the top of her profession and have the job that she always wanted more quickly than probably anyone in the field. It's just incredible. She always gets her way, which works great for her. It's taught me a lot of humility. My sister is one of my heroes. So it's really hard not to be influenced by your past and your experiences. I also think with some of my stories, it's a product of the age that I'm writing in. That the Molly Fide story, it's a cadet in the Space Academy who is wants to be a pilot and is told that women can only be navigators. If I was writing this 100 years from now, my hope is that it would be an arbitrary choice what her gender would be. That it would make just as much sense to say that men can't be pilots. And the readers would say, oh, I could see that. But for this story, if you want an underdog story, we live in an age where women are the underdogs. I've watched my mom was a math teacher, and I'm sure there's a lot of women in here who are in the STEM fields and know what that's like. My mom was, a math major in the 60s, and it was tough for her, and being a math teacher was tough for her as an adult. So that's, those are my influences, and my hope is that choice would be arbitrary in the future. But right now, if we want to tell an underdog story and maybe get people to empathize with someone they're not, my hope is that women read this and find strength, but more important, that men read this and say, oh, that's what that would feel like. If you're a white male and you haven't had to feel that, that's the thing that literature is the best at learning empathy and really falling into a character's mindset, seeing the world through their eyes, and understanding how other people feel besides yourself. I think that's the reason we should read literature if there's ever an ethical argument for reading besides just the fact that it's fun. That answer? Cool.
Okay, at the risk of sounding like a Philistine, I've kind of gotten into the habit lately of listening to some books using the audible.com. And of course, sometimes these Audible things, they got this, I don't know, they get actors or something to do the reading. And actually, they've been pretty good. Do you do that or have you explored that?
Yeah, audiobooks are, we don't talk about them enough, but that's one of the really incredible growth sides of this industry right now. My wife, who I've always considered myself an avid reader, I can't keep up with her. She blows through two or three books a week because she's doing a lot of it through audio. So whether she's doing yoga or driving to and from work, she's got a bit of a commute. She's just, gardening or anything, she's blasting through these books, and it's all because she can do it while she's doing other stuff. For self-published authors who have explored audio, it's been an incredible revenue stream. It's because more people are using that, but also because the amount of royalties per sale are pretty hefty. There's different ways you can do this as a self-published author. You could record your own, which I don't think I could do. I've been asked to record one of my short stories. My wife and I recorded it together, which was a lot of fun. We got to go up to New York and be in a booth, and we had someone telling us when we were messing up, which was important, because I wouldn't have known by myself that sounded wrong. But it's better to hire someone if you can. And Audible has this other side of it called ACX, the Audio Creation Exchange. And what it does is it pairs the voice actor with the author. And you can either pay them one time up front and you make all the royalties, or they can volunteer the recording and you split the royalties in half. Because as someone listens to audiobooks, often you don't follow authors, you follow narrators. Someone is so good at reading that, and they always command you know, top dollar, that they're only going to be reading probably stuff that people are investing in. That, you know, my stepmom just follows narrators. Like, whatever they record, she'll listen to. So you kind of are both invested in it, and you're both profiting from it. And it's a really cool system. But it's a way for, it can cost thousands of dollars to hire a recording, and this is a way to get for someone else to take the risk and share it with you. But yeah, I've tried, I've done all those. I've hired people, I've had people volunteer, and I've also regrettably suffered through the recording process, which is fascinating. Sure. Oh, you'll be next.
I was just wondering if there's any software that really helps. You see all these different gimmicks and all this software out there, white smoke to help you edit and other things to help you put the story in a sequence or something. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, they work for some people. There's a program called Scrivener that organizes your story by, everyone's writing that down right before I tell them how much I hate it. But Scrivener, and then I'm going to tell you, like, oh, no, don't get Scrivener. Maybe it'll work for you, but it has all these gadgets and gimmicks of you. Every chapter is a note card, and there's all note cards for making notes about scenes and places and every character, and you can rearrange them. Whenever I've opened these up, I'm like, okay, I'm going to spend my entire day playing with these tools and this interface instead of just writing. So I don't find those programs to be useful for me. I find staring at a blank document and forcing myself not to minimize it to check my email. If you stare at a blank document for 4 hours straight, that's writing. Even if you don't put a sentence down, the fact that you're being forced to think about, you know, to sit in silent contemplation rather than bouncing from one thing to another and distracting yourself and procrastinating, something is happening. When you go to sleep that night, whatever was blocking you, whatever you were trying to figure out, will be there the next day. Just like a math problem or a programming problem, you guys have all encountered this phenomenon. So for me, a nice blank document's the best. So I use a program called Pages, which comes on my MacBook Air. And the thing I love about it is it has a full screen mode where it's like completely black with just a white page and a word count. And that word count is like the finger pointing at me and staring at me. And that's all I need, is that motivation and no distractions. And it's unfortunate. If you use Pages now, it's probably a horrible program. I've like not upgraded it because they made the program worse over time. So I've got a version that works really nice, and they've made it poor since then. I think Word also on Macs, I'm not sure on PCs, has a view mode called Focus, which does the same kind of thing where it blacks everything out. That's what I recommend. Just a good word processor. For I haven't used any editing tools besides the built-in editing. I think if you're going to be a writer, it sounds miserable, but you should be reading some editing books as well. One I really highly recommend. Actually, everyone in here should read this book because it's hilarious. It's called Eats, Shoots, and Leaves by Lynn Truss, and is one of the laugh-out-loud funniest books you will ever read. And yes, it's about grammar. But seriously, I can't recommend that book highly enough. No matter whether you want to be a writer or not, it's just awesome. But if you want to be a writer, it's practically mandatory. There's a question here, and then if we can get the microphone to him.
Okay, so I wanted to ask about proofreaders. Do you think it's worth spending money on a proofreader, or is it better to have it done by your friends? And the other thing I've noticed is that it looks like the major publishing houses don't hire them anymore.
Well, it's a good point to bring up, because the budgets are getting slashed at publishing houses, and I'm with over 30 publishers now around the world, and I've worked with several in English, where I go through the editorial process with them, and you can see that it's not quite what it used to be. I think it's better to hire a proofreader if you can afford it. You can do it for a few hundred dollars. This is not the developmental editing where they're going to suggest scene changes and that sort of thing. This is going to get rid of typos and grammatical errors. I think it's worth hiring someone for that. I also think after you've done that, what publishers do, they take the edited manuscript and they give it to people in the publishing house. You know, the guy in the mailroom, everyone who's working on that book in the art department, in the marketing department, they all read it one last time and look for every single mistake. And they find them. Typos are like cockroaches. They scurry in when you're not looking. When you open the page, they go away. Because our brains are just amazing at assembling what is supposed to be there. If you want to save money, I've done this with some of my earlier books, read your book from the end to the beginning. So you're not seeing the story at all. You're reading every sentence in the opposite order. It's mind-numbing. It is so boring. But you're seeing every sentence individually instead of, well, I know what the next sentence is going to be, and I just put it together. I highly recommend that. Or another thing people do is they put it in a text-to-speech program, because your eyes will piece it together, but when the ears don't match what the eye is supposed to see there, it's very jarring. And you'll see, like, you'll hear the, and you're like, why did I not see that second the there? These are also things that once you do this enough, you'll start learning to do a global search for them. Double spaces, double periods, double infinitives, things like that. This gentleman, unless, yeah. Oh, what? Gosh, we've put him off three times already. All right, ladies first.
Okay, I had a question. Last year we had somebody here named Kendall Haven, and he told us about the eight great things to have to tell a good story. And I was wondering if you had things like that too. Like, did you have a special formula for a storytelling?
No, God, I feel like if it takes eight, I think I'm leaving some out, because I don't know. Seems a lot more complicated. I think the best training for good storytelling is to absorb as many stories as possible and as wide a variety of stories as possible. And we usually say to read a lot, but I've probably learned just as much about story arc from comic books, TV, film, every daydream I had in class. These were all working on ways to make story engaging. But the more you read, the more you see what works and what doesn't. But you know, I've picked up rules over the years from different authors that I think have stuck with me. I think it's Vonnegut's rules of writing, that things like start as close to the end of the story as possible. You know, the temptation to know your whole world and want to tell all the backstory and do info dumps, it's exciting to you because you made it up, but it's not exciting to anyone else. So skip that stuff. Also, don't write the things that readers skip over anyway. You know, just delete that stuff out. So there are tips like that that you pick up, but a lot of it's obvious once you start writing and getting feedback. And you know, one of the cool things about writing today and writing the Wool series in particular is that it was an exercise in writing with a live audience. And people have I don't know, not really mocked or criticized, but they've kind of look down on this writing style, which is kind of odd because this is how storytelling used to work. What I'm doing right now is more akin to the storytelling animal that we are than handing you a novel. It was with a live interaction. I could see people. I can watch everyone doze off and see someone laugh at something and remember, okay, next time, don't do that and do more of this. And that's how the Iliad and the Odyssey and Sir Gawain and the Green Knight and these stories were concocted. It was a collaborative endeavor. Matter of fact, the author was in the audience and he remembered the story and told a better version down the road, and someone in that audience is the one who actually set it down and changed it again. So getting your stories out there and listening to the feedback and taking that into account is another great way to learn how to write story. It might be the best way. I mean, why have an agent or an editor guess what people are going to think when you can just read online reviews and see what people think? It's the best market research possible. This better be good, because we've...
I know, a lot of pressure. Yeah. So as a science fiction writer, when you're dealing with science and technology, do you feel obligated to have a strong basis in real science, or that you can take a lot of liberties on your own and invent the science you need for your story?
Yeah, that's a good question. The biggest hurdle is when you know that you're doing something that shouldn't be done. Like, it's sometimes it's better to be stupid and not know that this would never work, because it haunts you. You need it for the story, so you have to do it. I think time travel is a gimmick that should never be in a story? Because, I know there's probably some theoretical physicists in here who's going to argue with me, but I just see time as a measure of change. And I think it only goes one direction, and it's not a mystical small letter T that we can actually make negative in equations and fiddle around with. I think it's just the state is not the same as it was, and what do we want to call that? What do we want to call the delta between those states? I think that's what time is. But boy, do I love a good time travel story. So I have to set that aside as a reader to enjoy it. As a writer, it's even harder to do things like there's a diving scene in Wool that I was a commercial diver. I've had the headaches from doing emergency ascents from 80 feet when my air runs out, and I felt the tickling of the bends. So I'm really familiar with what not to do in a diving scene. I worked around it in this story by making up something that's probably even more implausible. But for me, it was worth taking that risk and doing something that I knew was probably bad science in order to write what everyone tells me is their favorite scene in the book, and my favorite scene to write. When I was in the conference room at the bookstore where I did most of my writing, it was a very dark room. I would startle people. They would wander into the conference room to get through to the break room and then realize I was there and shriek, you know, because what crazy person sits in a dark room with all the lights off, you know, just staring at a laptop? But that's how I did a lot of my writing. And when I wrote that scene, I swear when it's time to get back to work, I looked up and there was a film of water over my eyes. I was looking through the water. Someone's nodding. I hear people say this when they're reading this. I was that absorbed in it. So at that point, I was like, screw the science, man. This is good stuff. You guys are not disappointing me with, I joked about this, and you're actually like the very furthest possible people who are asking the questions, and I love it.
Who's your favorite current author that maybe we've never heard of?
Oh, man, that's a good question. I could list a lot of people. I loved Max Berry's Lexicon. I'm not sure why he's not a household name. That book is amazing. The smartest person I've ever met, like living human being, is a guy named Ramez Nam, who wrote this trilogy. The first one's called Nexus, and he's absolutely brilliant. And then a friend of mine named Annie Belle, I just watched one of her series explode online, and getting to share that with her and know 3 years ago or 4 years ago I was going through this exact same thing, and that feeling, the terror and excitement that comes with that, watching that after like 30 published works, a lot of short stories, happened for her has been amazing. Most of what I read is nonfiction, so I don't follow a lot of authors because they publish a book every 10 years or something like that, you know. But from Malcolm Gladwell to Stuart Brand, and people are writing about like Clive Thompson, or I'm sorry, Chris Thompson, who is with Wired and now writes things like Smarter Than You Think, which is how, this is a great book. I think everyone in here would enjoy this book, Smarter Than You Think. Kevin Kelly, who wrote What Technology Wants, was also with Wired. People are writing about the future technology, how we're going to coexist. That's the kind of stuff I'm into.
So I'm curious about some of the controls on international sales. I would like to hear maybe your thoughts on that. I notice on Amazon that appears that when you upload books, it only has rights for sales in certain countries. And then also any comments you might have about the sort of fan fiction follow-ons to your silo stories.
Sure. Well, so different markets. I think iTunes probably has the most countries open because they've broken barriers with their music sales. And every place that they can sell music, they already have the systems in place to handle sales for apps and books and other things. So when you choose, like, select all countries in iTunes, it's a lot of countries. Amazon keeps rolling out different countries because they didn't have existing digital sales platforms in place like iTunes did. So they keep adding them, and you can opt in as you go. you can price match, or you can even have the price lower there than it would be in dollars here. There's another company called Kobo, which does great worldwide sales, and they're a good one for DRM-free EPUBs. But you can also sell the eBooks directly from your website, and that way anyone who has, you know, anyone not in North Korea can order your book. But if you have internet access, you can get a copy of it. Or you guys probably can't order it, because I don't think that you can access the internet from within Lawrence Livermore, can you? We had some funny run-ins with security already today. I did a lot of like stuff I wasn't supposed to do already, so I'm shocked that I got this far and got to give the talk. Like, we took pictures of me by the sign outside, and like there were like cars boxing us in. And then as soon as I got my badge, I like took a picture to put on Facebook. Oh my God, that is like the now like anyone wants to take a selfie, like badges, and it's just something you guys are used to. You take your badge off while you do it. So. I'll probably have to edit all that question. Out, because I probably just shared some kind of state secret.
So. I've got a question. If I'm not ready to write my big novel yet, but I want to get my feet wet and get started in short stories, I can't go publishing the short story as I'd be publishing a book. I've got to go through some magazine or some e-zine publishing to get the short story out there. How would you do that?
We're living in the renaissance of the short story. Not only does it fit in with people's reading habits and their hectic lifestyles. So Wool was a short story. It was a novelette, about 12,000 words. Would have been published in something like Asimov's back in the day, or one of the science fiction magazines. But instead, I made it available for 99 cents, and people could read it over their lunch break, and it went viral. It's what allowed me to quit my day job. So since then, I've published 3 short stories on my own. I've also done some for anthologies, because I have a hard time saying no. But the short stories do really, really well. You can submit them to a program called the Kindle Singles Program. If it gets accepted, you get double the royalty for the lower-priced ebooks. There's no harm in submitting it. You fire it off to, if you Google Kindle Singles, you'll find the website to upload. If it doesn't get accepted, you self-publish it, and you still make 35% on a 99 cent or $1.49, $1.99, wherever you want to price it. But I have quite a few works up for 99 cents, and people say, oh, you're devaluing literature by doing that. No, I'm not. I'm valuing the reader, and I'm also valuing myself, because normally I would have sold these to a magazine for a one-time $300 or $400 fee. Instead, I make 35 cents for the rest of my life anytime someone's downloads this. It adds up to a lot more than what we used to, you know, people would make a sale to these science magazines and just cheer and go crazy. And that was really devaluing yourself and the reader, I think. You also have a much wider readership by doing this. So write your short stories, self-publish them, get the feedback, and work your way up to the novel.
Are you making a distinction between self-publishing and sending it into the Kindle Singles, or is that the one?
They're very different things, because Kindle Singles is a curated platform. Not everyone can just say, well, I'm going to make it a Kindle Single, and they get to do it, because you get 65% or 70% royalties as a Kindle Single at that lower price point. If you self-publish at 99 cents, you only get 35%. So it is two different things, but it's a top-down approach. You go with your number one option. This is like my dating life, you know, like I'm going to ask her out, she's going to reject me. I'm going to work my way down. And
I think you must.
Honey,
have
this has nothing to do with you. Like, I don't know how, I don't know why you said yes, but like, this is how it used to work for me.
I think you must have covered it already. But when you say self-publish, where do I actually upload my
KDP, Kindle Direct Publishing? If you search Amazon KDP, do you have an Amazon account? Have you ever ordered from them? Okay, you already have a KDP account. It's the exact same login and password. So if you go there, you don't have to sign up for anything. You already have the account. You put in your name and password that you use to purchase things from Amazon, and say, what do I want to create? A book, a CD, there's different options. You say a book, it asks you for a file. You can make a cover art right in their program. They'll help you generate one, or you can upload it. You enter in the title, get some information, the price, you hit a button. Within hours. I'll tell you, this is what happens to me now. So I've been working on a book for 2 months. Done all the editorial phase, the beta readers, it's perfect. I'm exhausted. I've been working on this thing you know, 8-10 hours a day. So at 10 o'clock at night, I go through this whole process I'm describing to you. It takes 10 minutes to do, and I hit publish, and I go to bed exhausted. I don't have to think about that book. I wake up in the morning, and someone in Australia saw it go live, spent the whole day reading it, and I wake up to a review on Amazon and an email asking me when the next one's coming out. So that's how quick it all happens, that you don't even have, you don't even get a day off, which is a great problem to have, but you know, it really just highlights how easy and immediate all this is. It's transformative. I think that this era will be studied, because there's been nothing like this since Gutenberg refined the movable type printing press. No, I'm serious. It's the dissemination of entertainment and knowledge, and it's now created almost free and distributed almost for free. And if you can't, you know, you don't have to be a skilled mathematician to understand that, like, injecting zeros into equations changes everything. And that's what's happening right now. It's why the publishing world is upside down right now because of this.
Do you see any of the trends in self-publishing carrying over to nonfiction, like technical books, where, you know, technologies are changing on a monthly basis rather than, you know, the rate that print publishing has been able to catch up at, like, you know, if I want to go look at a technical book on some technology, the book's 3 or 4 years old, it's like 5 versions behind and essentially has no value anymore. Do you think self-publishing will be able to address any of those concerns?
Yeah, it already has. I'm amazed that this is ignored, really, because we think of nonfiction as coming in big, thick books, right? One of the most important human projects that we've undertaken, and we can't appreciate this because it's not as glamorous as a moonshot, but Wikipedia is probably one of the most important things that we have done as a species, and it's being done in so many languages. But the amount of data, and it's all good data. I mean, people used to look down on Wikipedia because anyone can edit it, but the people who spend their time editing it are usually experts in that field, and the citations have gotten so good. So that's nonfiction, and that is self-published. It's not gone through anyone. It's crowdsourced. It's defined the wiki that we all use in different industries now. For coding, you remember you used to go to Barnes & Noble and there were entire racks of different programming languages. All of that is online now. There's these entire websites and forums just devoted to coding, and because of object-oriented programming, people are just copying and pasting code with the comments intact right into their programs. It's become moduled. I know people who are already having tremendous success self-publishing nonfiction, whether it's short pieces on different, like a guide for one city, like the quick guide to Paris, or I know a guy who's just doing different plants, and he does a little short book on specific plants, and they're very cheap, and he's making a full-time living doing that. My guess, I think it's an even bigger question, because are these things going to affect literary fiction? Are they going to affect all the genres, all the types of writing? Yes. What's going to happen is the stigma of self-publishing is going to follow the stigma of these genres. So romance authors copped onto this first. They were already stigmatized. Yeah, they couldn't be made to feel bad about what they did. They already were. And you know, we laugh because it's true, but it's also sad that they were in that state. But really, their being beaten down the way they were for what they did was their biggest advantage. It became their armor, and they embraced these changes before anyone else. Self-publishing, we all know as fans of it, is stigmatized. So we were one of the first as well to embrace these changes. I think once everyone sees how liberating it is, how artistically creative you can be, and how financially rewarded you can be, literary fiction, nonfiction, the equations are the same for all these genres. It's just so new that a lot of them have not yet caught on to it. I'm getting looks and people are staring at clocks like, y'all need to be back at your desks before this place goes thermonuclear or something. So I want to thank you so much for your time and your questions. This could have gone for another hour, I can tell. So thank you so much for coming out. I really appreciate it.